Just up the coast from my dad's place was the little town of Mendocino, where my parents had first settled in 1968. Despite the fact that my dad had already worn out three wives and remained an incurable rambler, my parents' life in Mendocino sounds almost idyllic, more like one of my dad's romantic stories than a chapter of my own life.
Was hot and your mountains was cold. Arizona, California.
You should be looking at the scenery now, not me. This is very beautiful here. Unique, quaint, very unique, quaint little village. It sort of looks like New England in old whaling days. All old buildings, Victorian buildings.
So you don't want me to ask you any questions?
Well, you can if you think of one. I mean, I might answer it, I might not answer it. I'll just have to deal with it. Let's see what happens.
So you and Martha lived here for 5 years?
Well, not fully 5 years, because you guys, she and you took off with that strange, weird guy who had a name like John Gulledge. And he was a dope dealer, tennis player with the Bears Dick's place.
Where did you guys live?
You mean you guys?
I mean us guys.
Us guys?
Where did we live?
We lived. Want to go up there? It's 2 miles out of town, up Little Lake Road. Want to see the house?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll take you to the house. Riding in the car, car, take you riding in the car, car, take me riding in the car, I want to go riding in the car, car.
I can barely even remember my parents together anymore, so it's hard to believe there ever was a house. Still, I knew that Mendocino was the closest we ever came to being a family.
I want to ride in the front seat. I want to sit in the back seat, spice paddle on the front seat, riding in the car. Engine it goes, brrr. Turn my key, step on the starter. Ships and the boats go sailing by, clouds in the sky go flying by, cops and the house and the garbage can. Last one here. This one right here. I don't know if it's safe to pull in here. And I can back out if I have to, but I'd need somebody guiding me. This looks like it, though. Like that blue house used to be a garage. I don't remember there being a fence or a wall or something. This may not be the place. This is not the place. Could be this one. It hooked. It went in a little bit and it hooked. I don't think it was that one. It could be this one. There's no sign. No, that's too straight. That looks kind of like the place right there. This looks like our old driveway. No, that house is not the one.
How much time did you spend here?
I lived here for a total of 5 years.
But I mean, of that time...
Well, I'd be away on the road for a week or two, playing gigs, come back for a week or two. No more questions right now. I think we're already beyond it. We might have gone by it and I didn't recognize it. We'll have to do this another time, Iona. Oh, too bad.
I guess between your dad and me, you never were in one place very often. You know, you moved around a lot. And so you were being transferred from schools and you'd make friends and you were shuffled here and there. And you said to me one time, Mom, when I grow up, I'm gonna live in one house in one neighborhood for the rest of my life, and I'm never, never gonna move.
Before I knew Ramblejack, I thought they called him Ramblejack because of his travels, which he does, God knows. But it's because of the way he talks. I've never heard anybody that was so enchanting on subjects that I didn't give a damn about. I got him up on the stage one time, and he took so long to tune up. I said, listen, I know you don't hold a pistol up to Picasso's head and say, paint, but you gotta get started.
You got tuned up there? I got a singing welcome for you.
There, I seen it.
Ramblin' Jack, Ramblin' Jack, I sure am glad that you could ramble back.
Well, my boots are dusty and my head's a mess. I just flew in from the west.
Well, I was talking about you and somebody said, I believe Ramblin' Jack's dead.
Well, that somebody must have been crazy as hell, because you'd be the first guy I'd tell.
Hey, well, strap yourself in the gear of G, Bubba, and sing a song with me.
Take me home. My heart is heavy and my feet are sore. Take me home. I don't want to roam no more.
Say it, Jack.
Well, I've been from Boston to L.A., seen Boulder Dam and Frisco Bay, New York City and Washington, I've seen Montreal, Saskatchewan, and Rhode Island. And I worked in three all-night service stations and I drove a truck.
Why don't you take me home?
I can remember when Johnny Cash recorded this song. He said, I want to have Jack Elliott's guitar. If Jack isn't on it, I want to have somebody playing what Jack Elliott plays. God damn, I'm having a senior moment. I can't think what the song was.
Carpenter?
Yes, exactly. Carpenter. It was the one. And it was the way that Jack did it. That was and I think John and June had a hit on it with Jack Lick. But that's the story of his life. Was other people having hits on stuff that he might be responsible for.
Made a trip down to New Orleans one time with some friends of mine. We cut down through Virginia, North Carolina, and on down to New Orleans one summer. I think it was in 53. We had the name of a banjo picker to look up down there, a guy by the name of Billy Fair. Looked him up in the telephone directory. He invited us over to his pad at 912 Toulouse Street.
In 1969, Jack was signed to Warner Brothers and cut Young Brigham, an album which featured Tim Hardin's If I Were a Carpenter and Jack's own 912 Greens, the epic tale of his travels through the South.
And in the middle of the patio, there was this banana tree growing. I think it was a banana tree. It had a lot of bananas on it. Hanging there.
Young Brigham was Jack's most commercial album to date, but he still had nothing to show for his 15 years of performing and recording. And it wasn't long before the Warner Brothers deal turned sour as well. Bitter about never having received any royalties, Jack decided to boycott the recording industry altogether.
And did you ever stand and shiver
For my dad, a difficult means of making a living became even harder. He had to play shows constantly just to make ends meet, sometimes driving through the night so he could make it to the next day's gig in a far-off town, often arriving haggard and delirious. Maybe it was inevitable, considering the demands of the road and the social scene, along with a growing feeling that he was no longer appreciated, that my dad sometimes turned to drugs.
They were waiting for the sun to come up because Penny Baker was going to shoot a film of Jack walking around the railing of the balcony. Now, what did I say to you? We were 14, 15 flights up. And I know none of them were straight. I thought, oh, God, that's got to be the craziest.
That Jack's playing went down and singing went down.
He'd either, you know, fall asleep or get so angry that, yeah. He actually fell asleep once, yeah.
How does that happen?
He just kind of nodded off.
We were in Texas one time and he was doing a show. And this guy was buying me a drink. I mean, he was just buying me a drink. And Jack was on stage and he was playing. He's looking at this go down and suddenly he got paranoid. And he thought, this guy is gonna like run off with my woman. And he jumped off the stage in the middle of the song. He never stopped playing and he never stopped singing. He kept that song going. And he just wiggled his ass right over to the bar and he started playing really hard chords in the guy's face. And the guy was kind of looking at him, smiling. And all of a sudden he took the guitar and he just whacked the guy. I mean, he knocked two bar stools over. He knocked this guy flying, and I just ran for cover.
I think he got mad at somebody one time under the influence of something he shouldn't have been, threw a hatchet, which missed me by about that much, you know, just. And he said, oh, shit, I didn't mean to scare you, Arlo. Scare me? I said, fuck, you could have killed me, asshole. You know, I mean.
I was out in the West Coast doing my thing, singing and traveling around and performing. And
that's when your mother ran off with that hippie,
uh-huh.
John Gulledge.
Why did she do that?
I was performing in Nashville, Tennessee with Johnny Cash, and I guess she just thought that it was a hard life for me to be gone all the time, and she wanted somebody who was going to be around the house more. And she fell in love with John Gulledge, who had only one eye. And he was like helping her take care of you and kind of moving in on my territory. So when I got back, there was a 9-page letter explaining not to worry, but you were gone and you were with a good man whose name was John. And Caesar was out there waiting for me in the driveway. So I was glad to have his friendship.
Was that Mendocino?
That was Mendocino at the Shore property. But I'd been studying yoga, which is thanks to your mom, and that's why I didn't pick up a gun and shoot somebody, because I learned through yoga that when you don't have something or you miss something, it's because you didn't own it in the first place, and we don't own anything and don't have a right to go after it. But I went and talked to my yoga master about it, and he kind of giggled and said, "It's like you had a Cadillac and you left it parked somewhere with the keys in, and somebody jumped in and drove away. All you have to do is find the Cadillac, get in, and come home. Bring candy, bring flowers, be friendly."
Ahoy!
I talked to her about that.
I remember one time you were maybe three and your dad came to visit us for a day or so, and he left and you were so obnoxious, and I finally ended up taking you and putting you in your room. You're screaming and kicking, and that night I came in and you looked so sad, and you said to me, "I hate people when they go away because I love them and I don't want them to go."
By 1980, my dad had spent 30 years on the road and began to wonder whether he shouldn't try to settle down and find a new trade. He enrolled in wooden boat school and signed on for the restoration of the Alissa, a square-rigged Scottish sailing vessel built in 1877. But it was just a matter of time before Jack was back on the road, doing what he did best.
I just stopped by to get a cup of coffee now. Just stopped by to grab a cup of coffee. Don't give me no whiskey. Ain't got time for wine. I got to wheel that old semi down the line.
He sang his way from coast to coast, collecting friends and stories at every point along the way, all the time resembling more the heroes of his own childhood.
Oh, you're looking good.
Jack has lived more experiences than anyone I know, and he never can get them down on paper. So it's almost like you have to be on the boat, on the trip, in the moment, with him, to know who he is.
Arr, matey! Okay, get to a wide place.
No! No, we can't. We can't stop.
We can for a minute anyway. About explain to him that it's not gonna be, we can't visit long. Smell the diesel smoke? That's his Ford diesel truck.
I don't wanna stop at all.
Well, I don't wanna hurt his feelings. He's kind of, you know.
I know, but we'll get hung up talking to him for 40 minutes.
I've just been really frustrated that we still haven't had any time, me and you, to talk. And
well, let's talk now a little bit.
Okay.
And then we'll head over looking for the meals.
But even now, there's not that much time.
Oh, hey, you got that thing working? They might be here already.
I think so.
We better go look for them.
All right, but listen. You know, it's just doing this, you know, I've been just kind of going with your flow and going in the moment of things and, you know, trying not to interrupt things too much, but, you know, the result is that we haven't really had much time just to sit and talk. And now here's another day. I don't know how it happened, you know, but it's happened. And so, you know, maybe it would be a good idea.
I don't know exactly what your sit and talking sessions imply or what they encompass.
Like, what do you want to accomplish in the sitting and talking? Are you hoping to, like, uncork the mystery of what caused the fault between your mom and your pop? And get to the bottom of the mystery that caused so much pain and unhappiness? Every child of a broken marriage bears wounds from the damage that's been done, from the harm of having the mother and father separated so that the child doesn't grow up with the sense of love from two directions showered down upon them. Oh, somebody's here.
Surprise, surprise.
I think that was the hand of Jan. There's a door here. We're just getting ready to come out.
Okay. We were just interrupted, but, you know, you asked me a question. You said, you know, why do you want to talk about the past? Why do you want to sit down with me? Why do you want to do one-on-one? Hi. How you doing?
The thing is, I can't really remember ever having an actual conversation with my dad.
Okay. I got them, I got the trucks, I got the boats, I got the mules. I got everything but you, Dad. Yeah.
It just seems like I don't know what it means for him to be going around playing this
music.
Maybe
you're not supposed to know. You know what I mean? I'm not saying that it is. I mean, but here you are, obviously, you got camera, you got, you know, microphones, the whole thing. Maybe you want to know something, but you got to be you too. And there may be parts of him that you're just never going to know.
I don't usually use a set list, but there is one pasted on my guitar tonight. I prefer not to think about it as a rule. And I'm used to doing the shows off the top of my head, which is very exciting because there's very little up there. But I'm just reading these songs off a list that my daughter wrote for me, and I guess I owe it to her. I haven't been a very good father. And for all you people that can, you know, other bad fathers out there, I'm sure you're here tonight. I know, I attract them. But if we all haven't been right there every day with the pablum and the love and the time, quality time. That's the director here. Paid no mind.
If Jack had settled down, bought a nice little house, and got married, and raised a nice little family, and so on, I think Jack probably would have been happier. Although who could say? But he could not have been Jack Elliott. That he could not have done. So the world would have gotten one more good family man. In exchange, we would have lost Jack Elliott. Now, from my detached point of view, that's a good deal. We got the better of the deal. But what do you think?
Take a trip with me, 1913. To Calumet, Michigan, the copper country. Take you to a place called Italian Home. A minor
Christmas ball.
It's one thing for a six-year-old girl to tell her mother she can accept her crazy cowboy dad for what he is. It's quite another to ride across the country with that crazy cowboy 25 years later and not hold all those missed birthdays against